Okay, hi everyone. This is kind of a last minute organized meetup, so thanks Lucas for making it happen and thank you all for keeping here. So today I'm going to talk about our experiences in using C++ and Qt to deal with software models. As Lucas said, my name is Sandro. I work as a professor in the Federal Institute of Technology of Bahia in northeastern Brazil. I work basically in the field of software engineering. We have some courses over there, and we are trying to push our students to work with C++ and Qt in general there in Brazil. I've been using Qt in the last 17 years, I think, and also I'm involved with the KDE free software community for the last nearly 10 years, doing some development working in a KDE educational software for music instruction. I'm with the KDE Board of Directors for KDE EV, which is the legal organization behind KDE. Also there in South America, we've been doing some actions to foster the C++ and Qt use in the whole continent. So we have a lot of meetings there, like the Latin America KDE Contributors Summit. It happens in the last 6 or 7 years. Also last year we organized the first Qt conference in Latin America, which was Qt Con Brazil, so there are a lot of things happen there regarding C++ and Qt in general, right? What's this talk about? This talk is about software modeling or software meta modeling, which is somehow the kind of activities you do when you work with a tool for creating and handling UML or SysML or any models written in any other language, right? So here we want to support the creation and the transformation of such models using C++ and Qt. Why do we need software models? I do agree that software modeling isn't a task that developers like the most. We basically just love to do code, but we are not very excited about creating software models. And mostly because we think that the main purpose of such a model is only documentation. Of course, documentation is an interesting thing, but software models can be used in a lot of different purposes. Some of them very, very, very more useful and interesting than just documentation. For example, we can use software model to leverage automatic source code generator. Generation in order to ensure that your code follows an architecture that has been previously designed by an architect, and also we can use models and code in sync as the software development evolves. We can use models for when making architectural recovery. We inspect the software artifacts, and the final result we would like to have is a software model specified in some modeling notation, like UML, for example. And we can also use software models as a tool to enhance the quality assurance of our development. For example, and to ensure that the new development who is coming to the repository doesn't make any kind of architectural degradation. So we can use models along with continuous integration systems to automatically detect when the architecture deviates from what's being planned by the architects. Also, when the model is specified in a rigorous MOF notation, we can do a kind of simulation simulation for predicting how the software will behave when implemented. And also for domain-specific languages, you can use such models in runtime to provide a sort of self-adaptive behaviors in software. So there are a lot of reasons when we want to use software models, not just for documentation purpose. And so this is the basic of meta-modeling. I don't know how many of you have had some experience with doing some modeling things before, but this diagram summarizes how this modeling and meta-modeling activities work. So basically, when you open an UML tool and start creating some diagrams, you are working on this level. We call it a user model level or level M1. So basically, when you create a class in such a tool, what happens behind the scene is that the tool creates a lot of instances from classes defined in the language metamodel. So for instance, for UML, the language defines a set of 239 metaclasses that define the constructs, all the things you can use in your UML model, right? So this is an instance of a UML class. So when you create a property, you are actually instantiating another metaclass in the UML metamodel, and so on and so on. So to create this model, you need a metamodel, which defines what is available for use in UML. And in its turn, when the UML language was first specified, this metamodel needed to be written, defined also by using a language, which is the role of MOF, the meta language facility, is called a meta language, because if the language uses to specify the UML meta model, right? And so in its turn, MOF, the MOF meta model also needs to be defined in a meta modeling language, which in this case is the MOF itself. It's called a self-contained or a reflexive language, because MOF is defined in MOF itself. So, right. So this is basically the internals of any software modeling tools. And then, so the thing here is we want a tool that is flexible and extensible enough to handle not just UML model, but any kind of other model, any kind of other language which are also MOF-based, right? So UML is just one of those languages who are defined in terms of MOF. So the harder you work on these layers of meta-modeling levels, the more generic and flexible are the things, because if you define some feature or some behavior in the MOF meta level, such behavior will work for any MOF-based language, not just UML. Okay. And so, what's the current status for dealing with such models using C++? So, and many of you should be aware of all the facilities that the Java world provides for dealing with model, like the Eclipse modeling framework. It's a quite comprehensive set of libraries and tools to work with models. But we needed some, I think, which needed to be a bit different. Actually, this work was part of my PhD research I carried out some years ago at Federal University of Bahia there in Brazil. So in that work, we wanted to deal with a large set of models simultaneously. So we needed to work with an infrastructure that have a performances, but it was good enough to work with hundreds of software models simultaneously, because we were applying some techniques for doing some search for supporting the automatic design of software architectures. I'll talk a little bit about that later. So we wanted an infrastructure that was good enough and with good performance to support this kind of work. And also we wanted to make it in C++ because we like C++ and Q. So then I started developing the Qt modeling, Qt module, that I'll talk now. And because at that time there was a lack of libraries which supported, which allow us for dealing with software models. And also, as I came from the KDE community, having such a C++ library for dealing with models would be of more of would provide some benefits to and end-on tools like Qt Creator, Kdevelop, and many other IDEs with functionalities for dealing with software models inside the IDE tool. Right? Or, for example, to revamp Umbrella, which is the KDE tool for software for modeling things, but it uses a quite old UML method. Okay, so what's Qt modeling? It's a set of Qt add-on modules that provides a set of functionalities for dealing with models, all of them based, written in some language which was specified using the MOF meta language. So it's developed upstream, so the source code is currently in the Qt repositories, is a Qt project. Here is the URL for the wiki for the project. You can clone the source code from the Qt repository. So since the beginning we had some requirements that we wanted to fulfill, and we wanted Qt modeling to be 100% compliant with the object management group standards. So UML and MOF, they are standardized languages, and we wanted our implementation to support the language as the standard. And we also wanted it to be metamodal agnostic. We would like this work as an infrastructure, not just for UML models, but for any language, including the languages created by the user-defined languages. And also, we wanted it to perform well for a high number of models, because we had those requirements for searching for a set of hundreds of models. And also we wanted to provide a sort of model manipulation and creation via scripting in order to make things easier for the ones willing to contribute. So to address the first point, we wanted 100% compliance to object management group standards. We basically, when you go to the object management group web page, you can download the PDF specification for the language, which is a very big file of hundreds of pages saying what's the UML language about. But you can also download an XML file, which is an XML file describing all the meta classes for MOF and UML language. So what we did, we basically created a sort of C++ and Qt templates, and we used the Perl templates toolkit to automatically generate a basic implementation of MOF and UML language. So UML is a very, very expressive and big language. it would be possible to create all those code manually. So the good thing is that nearly 90% of such a code can be generated automatically from those XMI files. Right. The remaining one is from derived propers and operations, and that can be generated automatically, and then we need to implement those kind of. And also, some challenges that we face when doing that is that the MOF and UML meta model, they have a lot of dreaded diamonds, and Qt is actually not good when dealing with multiple inheritance and dreaded diamonds. Actually, it can deal with such models, but it has a lot of constraints. For example, if you derive from multiple classes, only one of those classes can be a Q object-based class, and it should be the first one in the list of base class. This kind of stuff. So I will talk a bit later how we sorted out this kind of thing. So to address the second point, we wanted it to be metabolically agnostic. We made extensive use of Qt's introspection facilities for creating a core and a tool that could work with any MOF-based library. Right? So we implemented such meta models as Qt plugins. So there are Qt plugins for UML, MOF, and you can create a new plugin for your defined language. And so the performance is quite good already, but there are room for some improvements, like make extensive use of copy-on-write capabilities, and improve a bit the implementation of derived union brokers, and share the objects when dealing with multiple models that can share some specific elements. And for scripting, we basically rely on Qt script that allows you to manipulate models using JavaScript with basically zero development effort. And development effort is basically for everything. So this is the basic architecture for Qt modeling. So on top of, so it's a set of add-ons modules. On top of the Qt 5, we have the Qt modeling module, which provides the basic functionalities for example for serializing models, the XMI formatting. Also, we had to extend some introspection features of Qt to support what we used at that time. Another module is the Qt modeling widgets, which provides a set of new models and views to handle those models. And then we have one plugin for each modeling language you want to use. Right? So we have a plugin for UML, a plugin for MOF. You can create models. So what do those such a plugin provide? So since we have that problem of Qt not being very good to deal with multiple inheritance and dreaded diamonds, so we basically made a Qt-free implementation of such a model, just using C++. Then we could sort it out this multiple inheritance and dreaded diamonds problems by using virtual inheritance and this kind of thing. So we have those languages implemented. And first, just by using C++, and we provide a set of Qt objects with wrappers around such C++ classes to provide all the introspection and things that we need to be with them. Which is fine, because if you want to to work with software models, but not using Qt, just C++. So there are just this thing here. Okay. And also we have the use tool that I will show you in a second. It started as an example on how to use Qt modeling, and it ended up evolving to a tool. That also provides a planning-based architecture where such plugins allows the use of such models inside the tools. And these are the currently supported features. I think I won't enter into details, but they are the kind of thing that you find in UML, meta model, and that should be handled by any modeling tool. Okay, this is an example of the C++ API. So here, basically, you are creating a new model programmatically. So all of those classes, they came from the UML specification. They were automatically generated by our template system. And so basically, we are creating a model that contains a package that defines a class with a property. And we tie up things here to create your models. Once your model created, you can manipulate and do all kind of stuff that you want to do. And of course, this isn't a very productive way of creating a model. Even though you may have such demand for doing this kind of stuff, but the mostly used case is just to load a model for an XML file, or to serialize, to write your model down to an XML file. So here is how it works. So the Qt modeling module provides this QXML writer class, where you can just pass your model here and it serializes your model. So it's from the Qt modeling add-on. And since we wanted to have a metamodel agnostic infrastructure, so this class can automatically discover in runtime which metamodel should be used to serialize those files by inspecting the namespaces that here when reading, right? When you are about to read an XML file, it first looks for this attribute here, and then based on this URL, it finds the right plugin, the right metamodel plugin to use to explore, to load your. So this is the tool. It started actually as an example. It evolved into something more interesting. So basically, here we have the things that are provided by the Qt modeling widgets add-on, like a view to visualize your model, or another view which is a property editor that displays all the properties for a selected element. Right. Here we have a JavaScript console where you can just manipulate or do some queries on your model to investigate things. For example, this is a script just to detect whether your model has multiple inheritance, for example, because we want to ensure that your model doesn't have multiple inheritance. So the nice thing is that because of Qt script capabilities, you can just inspect your elements by using the methods and attributes that are defined in the UML metamodel. Right? Also, all of these properties are discovered by using the Qt introspection capabilities. So it doesn't work only for UML, but it also will work when you define your own language. Right? So these are the plugins we developed for this tool. So basically, we have a plugin for each meta model language we want to support, and then another model, another plugins for example for the JavaScript console, and we have some plugins for which deals with country syntax, which is this sort of diagram you are used to work with, and another things. And so this is the script I just show you. And so basically we register the objects that are presented in your model in the Qt's JavaScript engine, and then we can just start doing some queries and changing model elements by using JavaScript. An alternative for that would be to use OCL, which is the Object Constraint Language, which is a nice thing because it's part of the standard UML, but it has a lot of quite of weird grammar, and it's quite complicated to implement a new interpreter for OCL. And then we went with JavaScript because Qt gives that for free with no development. In addition, it can change the models because OCL is a language only for query models. You can change things by using OCL. And when you use an UML tool to provide some modeling thing, basically what you see here isn't the model itself, it's what's called concrete syntax. The model itself is a tree of objects instantiated from the meta model. And so for the concrete syntax, we implemented it by using QML. How many of you are using QML programming? Okay, good. So this is actually a thing that we can actually see all the benefits of using QML, because we can implement this kind of stuff with actually a very, very few lines of code. So for example, for handling a class, the basic QML code is just this here. We have three slots, one slot for the class name, another slot which has a list view whose model is the attributes for an element. Those properties also came from the UML meta model. They are all available for use inside QML. So it's quite easy and productive to implement such concrete syntax things using QML. We basically had to implement all this kind of stuff, and because as part of my PhD project we were working with self-adaptive systems, which is basically the term we use to describe the software that needs to change itself in accordance with things happen in the environment and in the software itself. And so what we did, we basically created a new modeling language for defining the design and space. Our goal was to capture all the knowledge of an experienced architect for self-adaptive systems in a thing that we call design space. So also we wanted it to be a generic platform. We created a design space for architecting self-adaptive systems, but we wanted it to be available for other system domains like gaming or mobile things or web things. So we first defined a new modeling language like UML, but a modeling language for defining design space. Then we created a very, very huge design space for self-adaptive systems, which allows you to give a model as input to those tools, and then by using multi-objective optimization techniques, we search this huge space for the best architectures that provides the self-adaptive behaviors, behavior in much to system, right? So basically, this design space allow all sorts of combination of techniques for creating self-adaptive systems, and the result is a huge, huge set of different architectures. Some of them are really, really bad architectures. Some of them are reasonable architectures, and there are some in that huge design space that are maybe very, 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 very good architectures. So we use the optimization techniques to search in such design space, looking for those exceptional architectures. So for that, we also had to implement another Qt module, which was the Qt optimization module. It was highly influenced by JMetal, which is a Java library for doing optimization stuff. Qt optimization provides an implementation of SGA2 algorithm, which is an elitist evolutionary algorithm for navigating in such design space, looking for good architectures, and the result is what's called a Pareto front of good architectures, from where the architects can pick up one desired architecture to actually implement. Okay, but that is a topic for another talk. I want to enter into the table. And so, in conclusion, Qt modeling allows you to handle software models programmatically because you want to use them as part of your CI infrastructure, or you want to create scripts to automatize your work. Still a lot of work to do, and we can wonder how interesting it is for currently using IDEs or as part of other stuff. And it's free software, so if you want to play with things and start to contribute to things, just try it, and if feedback is quite welcome. Okay, thanks. For complex software, doing with such a model can be a very easy way. And if I remember correctly, I think the UML or MOF standard, they do support a kind of splitting models where you can import a model from another one. So if, instead of having all your specification in a big file, you can split things and just import the ones you want to make it more modular and so on. But of course, we don't want to use this kind of thing to model all of your software, right? Maybe it can be more useful if you are doing only high level architectural modeling, where you can just regulate in which abstraction level we want to model your software. So if you keep things on a very, very high abstraction layer, maybe the models become to be more more actually useful in order to give up too many details, right? But I do agree with you. There are actually I don't know how the proprietary tools, what's the current status of systems tools for dealing with complex and real projects, but yeah, at least for free software tools, there are a lot of room to improve.
Do your tools also support code generation for models, and do your tools support scanning code and grading for models? So that it is possible in both directions?
Actually, we don't support any code generation yet in the tool. I had one student that made his final project working with architectural recovery. So basically, he implemented on top of this tool a set of plugins that could look into your source code and use different recovery algorithms to provide a sort of high-level model of your software. Currently we can't generate source code, but it's a matter of using some template engineering like Grantly or this kind of stuff to convert the model into source code. Yeah. I don't know if that was your question.
Yeah, my question was generating code out of the model and updating the model from the existing
code. Okay, so this is a problem.
My question is unusual because when UML is more than just class diagrams are like very static. So there are like sequence diagrams that contain like runtime, execution, and so on. Does this module of QT like support these different diagrams?
As I said, we were able to automatically generate nearly 90% of UML and functionalities, so all of those things are already available to use in the C++ API. Of course, we didn't implement all the country syntax for those things, so currently you can just use this tool and start creating your sequence diagrams visually, but you can do that by stretching or by using all the required things to inspect and manipulate and create a new project or a new diagram or a new component or a new UML device node, all this thing is already generated. But the concrete syntax things is still a lot of
memory. You talk about the optimization architectures in the states, you describe on a high level.
To compare to yes, and so basically in our language for defining new design space, and we created a set of concepts to define such a space. So basically, it's a set of mutually orthogonal axes which describes a given concern that you need to address when designing architecture for a given domain. And in each one of those axes, we have a set of points where each one of those points contributes, extends your initial model with new elements that when together implements a given self-adaptive behavior, for example, in our case. And so what the tool does is you pass it an initial model, which is your software with no self-adaptive behavior, and then the tool starts moving these architectures, this initial architecture, in all the possible combination points of such space, extending the architecture with new things. And for each one of such generated architecture, we define a set of metrics that can somehow estimate how good this architecture performance. And then it turns into a common multi-objective optimization problem, right? And you can apply any of those things that are available over there to look for multi-objectives. In general, is that?
I mean, normally when you think about UML and all those tools, you think about object-oriented design.
Yeah.
And not, that's not the only paradigm that exists. But not like pure functional out what, like, does it handle different ways of designing software?
So UML is a language for modeling object-oriented systems and processes, right?
Yeah.
But of course, you can create a new language for doing some modeling for functional or for any kind of stuff for another paradigm. I don't know if there are already any language for modeling functional or software written in another paradigm. So if such a language there already exists, and if it's based on MOF, so this is ready to support models written on those languages. If it doesn't exist, you can create one huge. The only thing you have to do is specify that new language using MOF. You create an XMI, a new XMI file, and you use our scripts to automatically generate the metamodel, the plugins, and you start doing. So this is your real model, right? But you don't want to look at those things. But basically, this is why it is contained in the XML files. And here, for the selected element, you can just inspect and change all of the attributes, right? A nice thing already is that if you hover a given property, you have this toolchip, which shows some documentation that is collected directly from the XML file, directly from the specification. So the tools ends up being a nice thing to learn UML. For example, I wanted to know what this final thing means. I want to know what does leaf mean. So let me just over here, you can read directly the official documentation that came from the XMI file. So it's nice to learn all of those things from UML. So here you have the JavaScript console. We defined a variable which is called self, which means the current selected element. So here we can run your JavaScript thing, and you have the result of the script you can show here. I can, for example, open this script that look for multiple inheritance on your elements. When you run, the result is false because there are no multiple inheritance in any multiple element. So here is the concrete sentence. This still needs a lot of work because currently we need to add manually a given element to the concrete syntax. So this is the QML thing that I showed you before, showing the attributes and methods and so on. So, yeah, but currently we can just create a new element visually by. Yeah.
you can just create a new application, import the Qt module, at the moment just using that C++ API I showed you before to do some serialization and changing model elements without the tool. Stuff and integrated Qt Creator. Actually, there are different efforts that actually you can use some UML stuff inside Qt Creator. And I think it's an experimental plugin you need to enable it before using. And Qt Creator currently can also handle some state machines. Things, but it uses a different standard, which is the SysML. It's not a UML; it's a different standard. But yeah, I think the final end of story for such of this thing is having it integrated into Qt Creator, Qt Dialog, like it's already available for Qt. So if you want to do it, please.
Okay,
so thanks for coming.